Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dark Matters, Exodus, by Michael Dow. Narrated by Graham Halstead. 1. Be thankful we're not getting all the government we're paying for. Will Rogers.
She's a United States citizen, Madam President. We can't just leave her to rot.
Secretary of State Bonnie Dalton spoke softly, but there was no mistaking her resolve. When necessary, she could be as cold and calculating as any of the president's inner circle. But even she had her limits, and the current crisis, it seemed, might soon put those limits to the test.
"I'm fully aware of that," the president replied, a bit more tersely than Bonnie would have liked. "But she also launched an unprovoked attack on the Republic of Iran."
Bonnie shook her head.
"I think we've established, ma'am, that that was never her intent.
The Iranians don't see it that way."
Bonnie took a moment to consider her response. The president needed a clean way out of the mess in Iran, and as Secretary of State, it was her job to find one. But this was uncharted territory, to say the least. And worse, the world was watching. It had been almost 5 months since the events in Ramsar, and still, Monique Durand remained in the custody of the Iranian government. Their best efforts to negotiate her release had been for naught, no thanks to the now ubiquitous videos of the event which did nothing to aid her cause. Not for the first time, Bonnie wondered how the news trucks had managed to arrive in Ramsar at nearly the same time as Monique had. But that was just one of several unanswered questions.
"The Iranians will see it in whatever way serves them best," Bonnie said at last. "They need a way to save face, no different than we do, and the United Nations is the best avenue to do that, for both of us."
"What the UN wants is unprecedented," the president replied.
"It's bad enough they've abandoned New York and that we're forced to involve them every time we want to negotiate an international treaty. Now they want to put a US citizen on trial? Not on my watch."
"It's not a trial," Bonnie said. "We'll call it a hearing, and they're offering to hold it at the headquarters in Geneva, not at the Court of Justice in The Hague."
"Semantics. If they decide her fate, it's a trial."
"Maybe, but the words matter. You know that. We can shape public opinion, especially here in the US, and Ambassador Henry tells us he'll have significant sway during the proceedings. He'll help ensure we get a favorable outcome. Ambassador Henry is an idiot,
but he's a well-connected idiot. That's why we appointed him, and why this is our best option.
Second best option. Negotiating her release on our own is our best option.
We've tried that for almost 5 months. We're at a stalemate. To keep beating our head against that wall while she remains locked up makes us look weak. Or worse, indifferent.
The president turned away, crossing the room to stand at the second of three tall windows directly behind the resolute desk. It was a good sign. She didn't change her mind often, especially here in the Oval Office. But when she did, it usually happened like this, with her back turned and her face hidden. Bonnie knew enough to remain silent, awaiting her response.
"It's those videos," the president said at last. "Without them, this is a non-event. Instead, we have 10 billion people involved."
Bonnie nodded.
"They're still getting more airtime than any of the reality shows, even Running Man Russia. And the Durand woman remains tight-lipped about the whole ordeal. Her friends aren't talking either.
Ashraf went to see her again yesterday, nothing new to report."
Now the president nodded, though she remained with her back to Bonnie, gazing out the window.
"At least Ambassador Gorbani is someone I can trust."
Bonnie jumped at the opening.
"Exactly. He'll make sure we don't end up with the short end of the stick. To be honest, I think people are a lot more interested in what she was doing and what the hell that cyclone thing was than they are in what happens to her. Ashraf can coach her through the proper answers. But if she still won't answer any questions, even from the UN panel, then the consequences are on her.
We still have no idea what she was doing in Ramsar, and why she won't talk to us. Ashraf says she's stubborn, and not in any big hurry to leave Iran, apparently. What about her family? Anything else from her father?
No, not recently. He'll be asked to testify, I'm sure. Whether he shows up to speak, who knows. But my guess is that they have more interest in questioning Andre Durand than they do in questioning his daughter. They'd love to prove that he manipulated her genetics in violation of the Adonis Treaty.
Do you think she's some sort of genetic freak, that she somehow created that tornado?
I'm sure there's a scientific explanation. It's probably why the Iranians continue to hold Professor Hanssen rather than letting him go, like they did with the rest of her group. There must be a link.
The link is that they're both Americans. The others weren't.
Maybe, but I expect it's more than that, and we don't know what she may have told the Iranians.
What about that other man, the one who disappeared into the funnel? Has he been found?
No. We've got several good pictures of him, and yet the search bots can't find a match.
And not only in the official databases, but across the unofficial ones as well. Not even traffic cams. It's like he doesn't exist.
We're still looking and doing some old-fashioned back-channel legwork.
Their best guess at this point is that he's someone who's had a facial reconstruct.
More unanswered questions, the president mumbled.
Bonnie wasn't sure whether the president had intended for her to hear the words, so again she waited. Though, as was often the case, she didn't wait long.
I still don't like it, the president said. Let's give the negotiations one last shot. Up the ante. What if we offer to accelerate their fusion power program? They could use our help.
We've been upping the ante for months. Nothing we can afford to offer is going to trump Iran's chance at a Security Council seat.
Exactly. This whole thing is nothing more than the latest power grab by the UN. Another step toward global governance at the expense of the individual nation. I built my campaign around reducing the UN's grip on American policy and bringing us back as a world power. Yet here we are, playing puppet to their agenda. Again.
No one could have predicted this. President Lynch had over 2 months to resolve it himself.
It wasn't the first time Bonnie had felt the need to remind the president of the fact.
He was a lame duck, the president countered. We should have been better prepared. Now it's derailing my own agenda.
Your agenda hasn't been derailed.
Did you see this morning's unemployment numbers?
You've been in office barely 2 months. Give it some time.
America doesn't have time. We promised an end to this downward spiral. This Durand thing is sapping precious time and resources.
She's a one-off, Bonnie replied.
This isn't another space treaty or water rights negotiation. It's a couple of American tourists on some sort of personal mission of discovery in Iran. The hearing will make for a few days of entertainment, and then it's done. For most of the planet, it's a diversion from the drudgery of daily life. She pleads her case, the panel declares her harmless, and everyone moves on. We move on.
With another adversary on the Security Council. The president had turned from the window to face her.
She's not ready to change her mind.
Bonnie did her best not to react, though she did return the president's stare. There were a few more seconds of awkward silence before the president continued.
What about Hanssen, she said, and the asteroid business? GRI is all over me about it. They don't want the UN sticking their nose into it any more than I do.
The explosion was on U.S. soil. The victims were all Americans. That whole topic will be off limits. I don't think the UN or the Iranians will have an issue with that. Their focus is on Monique Durand and her father, and the spectacle in that video.
That asteroid is its own spectacle.
It is, but it's a UN treaty that allows it to be brought back into Earth's orbit. I doubt they want to remind people of that any more than you do.
They won't have much choice if there turns out to be a link.
What if the scientific explanation for Ramsar somehow involves the asteroid?
Bonnie shook her head.
I doubt the asteroid is involved. It was still 100 million miles away when all this happened.
They'll have to establish Hanssen's role, and why he was with her. Who knows where that conversation could lead?
The link is dark matter, not the asteroid. Hanssen's business partner told us the two of them were searching for dark matter. They were in Ramsar because it's the most naturally radioactive spot on Earth. We're not sure how that relates, but the science is most likely tied to dark matter.
What if it's more than that? What if she is some sort of genetic freak, and she's waiting to have a worldwide stage before she opens her mouth? She could be pushing her own agenda.
What kind of agenda? One that would justify spending months in an Iranian jail cell? There are better ways to get attention, especially for her. I don't think that's her motive.
Maybe it's a family motive, something about her father, some kind of retribution.
That's ancient history. Monique wasn't even born when the UN passed the Adonis Treaty.
Any retribution from the hearings would be between André Durand and Secretary General Girard. From what I've heard, there isn't much of a relationship between Monique and her father. They haven't spoken in years. He certainly hasn't made any effort to extract her from Iran, at least not that I'm aware of.
No, he hasn't, the president agreed.
She crossed the room again, stopping directly in front of her.
I'll consider the hearing, she said, but not in Geneva. Somewhere neutral, away from their power base. Someone friendly to our views, as well as to Iran.
Maybe in Turkey, Bonnie offered. She liked the idea, not only because it met the president's criteria, but because the American ambassador to Turkey was a family friend.
Fine, but I also want you to talk with Ashraf. Let's try one more time to get Monique Durand's story. We need to confirm that this is no more than a science experiment gone wrong.
At last, some progress. Maybe they could finally put this behind them.
Agreed, she said. A science experiment gone wrong. And I want assurances from the UN. We won't allow them to use this hearing as another chance to pontificate on the benefits of global governance, or to take swipes at American foreign policy, or to make outrageous conspiracy claims related to American companies. It's a science experiment gone wrong. Nothing more.
Get Ambassador Henry working on an approved list of questions. I want him working his way through something other than a who's who of Geneva's socialites.
Bonnie did her best to suppress a smile.
I'm on it, she said.
Thank you, that's all.
The president turned away, returning to her desk. She made her usual dismissive gesture with her left hand. Bonnie hated when she did that. But this time Bonnie ignored it. She had one more item she wanted to discuss. It probably wasn't the best moment to bring it up, but it was now or never. She wasn't likely to get another opportunity to be alone with the president before it was too late. So she remained where she stood. It took several seconds before the president looked up from her desk. She seemed genuinely surprised to see that Bonnie remained in the Oval Office.
Bonnie? One more item, Madam President. It's quick.
I'm listening, she said. Her facial expression didn't convey nearly the same message, Bonnie noted. Still, the president had given her the window. Bonnie forged ahead.
It's about the space hotels, the world view and the star view and this grand opening event.
The golden ticket thing.
Yes. Did you know that not a single person from the administration has been invited?
No, I didn't know that.
Don't you find it strange, after all we've done to support them? It seems like a slap in the face.
A few senators are going, the president responded. Tony Pavisi, I think.
But no one from your staff. It doesn't seem right.
I'll get over it, she said.
Besides, it's an expensive ticket. They probably didn't want to deal with the executive branch gifting rules. I'm sure a ticket would be permissible under the new personal hospitality exemptions.
Am I going to have to spell it out for her? Bonnie hoped not.
There was another pause as the president put down the piece of paper she had retrieved from her desk. She studied Bonnie for a moment from her seat before the smallest of smirks crossed her lips.
It might, she said at last. Maybe we should send someone. In fact, I'm thinking the Secretary of State would be appropriate.
Bingo. Ma'am, I'd be honored to represent you. Do you think you could find a ticket?
This time, the president didn't hesitate. I'll see what I can do, she said. Thank you, ma'am. Now go deal with the Iranians, she said, again making the gesture with her left hand. Bonnie barely noticed, slipping out the side door and smiling to each of the president's various assistants as she passed through the outer office. Onward and upward, Bonnie thought. Her sources had confirmed that there wouldn't be more than a handful of politicians or government officials at the Golden Ticket event. It would be a rare gathering of the world's elite, the true movers and shakers. Her ability to secure a ticket would be noticed, hopefully by the right people. Bonnie was no fool. The days when American presidents moved mountains and led the free world had long since passed them by. As much as she respected her longtime friend, this president would likely have even less of an impact than her predecessor. It was time for Bonnie to cash in on her decades of public service, and the Golden Ticket event would be the perfect place to start. 2. Human history becomes more and more a race between education and catastrophe. H.G. Wells. This time, the executive committee met at Jules Verne, sharing a long, oval-shaped table overlooking the Paris skyline, high atop the Eiffel Tower. The setting was another virtual reality construct from the chairman's holophone, of course. The actual restaurant and iconic spire had been destroyed by terrorists nearly 20 years prior. But the chairman was in a nostalgic mood. The restaurant had been one of his favorites during his many years in Paris. He permitted himself the small pleasure.
Reminiscing,
his longtime colleague, referred to by members of the executive committee as One, was the first to arrive. He materialized in his pre-assigned seat to the right of the chairman.
Guilty, Your Honor, the chairman replied. Though all this will be coming with us, you know.
Sure, but it's not quite the same as the real thing, is it?
The chairman shook his head.
I suppose not, but we'll be able to stand at the peak of Mount Everest, or inside the Sistine Chapel, or on the rim of the Grand Canyon, sun at your back, wind in your hair, and barely know the difference.
Until you try to climb down.
I suppose, but who wants to climb down? I'd rather spend the time looping through a dozen of my favorite spots than sweat my way down a dusty, crowded, donkey manure lined trail to the Colorado River.
Tell that to the kids who will be joining us.
I will, right after I introduce them to our next generation full immersion virtual reality rooms. Did I tell you I gave a few of my golden tickets to the VR programming team?
You did. I also heard that one of them had a fatal heart attack a few weeks ago during system testing.
The chairman nodded.
A horrible tragedy. Though it's incredible how easily the brain is fooled by a simulation that perfectly emulates all the senses.
We should set some limits. We can't afford to lose kids. It's a long trip.
Again, the chairman nodded.
Already done.
The remainder of the executive committee had arrived. Number 9, Rudy Dersch, was the last in the seat to the chairman's left.
Let's get started, the chairman said. We've got a lot to cover.
And not much time to do it, Four added.
First, the invitees. Where are we with the numbers?
We're close,
Five responded. She was leading coordination efforts for the 20,000 golden tickets, an unenviable task, to say the least. She had been a good choice, though. She was highly organized, methodical, and generally even-handed. And equally important, the rest of the executive committee trusted her. The chairman was happy to have offloaded the task.
We have over 19,000 confirmed, and better yet, the Tier 1 list is all but complete.
All but complete? The chairman asked. What's still missing?
We're a bit short on robotics, most notably engineers capable of maintaining the surgical center equipment.
How short?
A few. It's the only category still short of the launch minimum. But we're a half dozen short of the target.
Sounds like another job for 9, the chairman said, turning to Rudy. Can you help?
Rudy nodded.
It's pretty late notice, but I'll see what I can do.
Look for younger folks, the chairman said.
Our demographics are skewing a bit too old. Some 40-something up-and-comers would be best. And single, we need them to stay with us for the trip, not just join us for the golden ticket event. At this point, we're better off if we don't have to convince entire families.
That's a tall order, Six said. We should all check our waiting lists.
I've done that, Five said. The rest of our shortfall can probably be covered from the waiting lists. We still need propulsion engineers, some botanists, and a few other odds and ends. Those I can find from your waiting lists, but not the specialized roboticists.
At 19,000, we have 1,000 open slots, Three said. We should already be pulling more names from the waiting lists.
We need the open slots, the chairman responded. We have to fill all of the Tier 1 needs.
We're short a handful of Tier 1s, not 1,000. I'll say it again, let's pull more from the waiting lists.
We're less than a week from departure, One said. It's a lot of work for what's likely to be very few additions, and the waiting lists haven't been vetted like we did with the initial lists.
Mine have, Three replied.
Mine as well, Six added.
I'm less concerned about whether the final count is 19,000 or 20,000, Eight said. I'm more concerned about how many of them stay on board once we announce our plans. Frankly, it's a miracle our plans haven't already been leaked. Every morning I wake up expecting to see a headline screaming golden tickets headed to the stars all over the news feeds.
A leak isn't the issue, Three said. It's someone poking around and putting two and two together. The strange mix of invitees, the massive amount of supplies being brought on board, and the surge in helium-3 production. It wouldn't be hard to do the math.
No one else has access to all of that data, the chairman said. It would be wild speculation. Our media assets have control of that.
Not to mention, Seven added, the media doesn't do math.
What about the black market sales? Six asked. The media's been doing that math. I've heard reports of tickets for sale north of 500,000 each.
That was a communication issue, the chairman responded. We've made it clear the tickets aren't transferable. No one can get onto a shuttle without being on the list. The biometric systems are in place. No one will be able to sneak on board.
Have guests begun to arrive? Five asked.
One nodded. He led the on-site preparations.
They have. It's a busy schedule. We let some guests arrive a few weeks in advance, especially the Tier 1 guests. It helped spread the load. It's a lot of people to get into space.
My net worth is well aware, Three said.
As is mine, the chairman added.
In less than a week, that will all be irrelevant. But you do have a point regarding the 1,000 empty slots. I don't want to fill them all yet, but I think we could fill half, say 50 more from each of your waiting lists. Agreed?
Several heads nodded as Rudy spoke.
I don't need the allocation. There aren't that many on my list, and they haven't been sufficiently vetted. I'd offer to concentrate on filling the Tier 1 slots and give my allocation to the rest of you.
Smart man, the chairman thought. The battle wounds from Rudy's nomination and acceptance to the executive committee were still fresh. Rudy continued to do all he could to help heal them.
Excellent, the chairman said. Let's say 60 for each of the rest of you. These will be the last additions. 19,000 is well above our target. Plus, we built some wiggle room into the Tier 1 numbers, including the launch minimums. But I'm confident 9 can shore those up. That should be our priority.
Speaking of 9, Three said, where are we with the Hanssen asteroid?
Still on track, Rudy said. It's set to arrive this weekend, right on schedule. The trajectory is still good. The boosters are ready.
Where is it now? Seven asked.
Rudy paused before answering, but only for a moment.
2.5 million miles away, give or take. About 4 million kilometers.
Amazing how much hysteria can be generated by a rock that's still 2 million miles away, Four said.
It's a rock traveling at over 30,000 miles an hour, Rudy replied. The smallest shift in trajectory, less than 1%, would put it on a collision course with Earth. Even all of the attached fusion boosters don't help some people sleep at night.
The media is having a field day with doomsday scenarios. Can't we do anything about that?
Three looked directly to Rudy as she spoke. We're doing our best to counteract it using GRI's media assets, Rudy said. And I'm sure you've seen me on the news feeds talking about all our redundant fail-safes, warning systems, and monitoring technologies. But it's tough for words to stack up against sensationalized video of a hypothetical impact. Fortunately for us, the chairman broke in, the UN is taking most of the heat. I'm sure they regret acquiescing to such a large size limit. Nine has done a fine job in redirecting the debate to the Piazzi Treaty and the 500-foot threshold. Intellectually and from a cost-benefit standpoint, the size limit makes sense. But it's clear no one really thought through the psychological and emotional factors. How long until we fire the boosters and redirect it away from Earth and toward our intended path? Six asked. We're still finalizing the numbers, the chairman replied. The sooner we do it, the less energy required. Plus, the shift away from Earth will immediately reduce the paranoia, though it also tips our hand, so we'll wait until we're all safely aboard the Worldview. Don't worry, he added. The asteroid's trajectory doesn't cross our path. No need to keep an eye out from your living room windows. You won't actually see the asteroid for months.
Is that the best plan? Five asked. I thought we needed it sooner. Or at least don't we need the boosters?
The chairman shook his head. We're still finding more asteroids, almost every week. Two good-sized candidates in the past month alone. And we have plenty of boosters. At this point, the Hanssen asteroid is as much insurance policy as it is our ticket to Alpha Centauri.
Assuming the nanoship data are good, and Olympus turns out to be all that we hoped.
And there's the rub. One was right, of course. The decades of behind-the-scenes planning, the thousands of nanoships launched toward the stars, and the discovery of the planet they called Olympus. It would all be for naught if they had missed something. Some small yet critical flaw in the planet's environment. But they were long past that debate. We all know the risks, the chairman replied, and we've spent our life's fortunes to overcome them. I still like our chances.
Let's talk about the risks, Three said, and the real reason for this meeting, the UN hearing, and the demands that you testify.
Technically, it's a request. That's the difference between a hearing and a trial.
You convinced them to make it a hearing, but you couldn't avoid being called to testify, and you couldn't get it delayed, even for a few more days. The timing is hard to fathom.
I'll grant you, it's not what I had hoped, but as I've said, it can be managed. It will be managed. The focus is Monique and what happened in Iran. We have assurances that the asteroid and the business in Hawaii will be off-limits.
But you won't be off-limits. Any investigation of Monique ultimately leads to you, to Telios genetics, and who knows where that could lead, or how long it might drag on.
It leads to an estranged father-daughter relationship, and some wild speculation as to where these powers of hers come from. That's it. Any potential link to us and our plans will prove to be a dead end.
Let's hope so, but I still don't think that's the whole story, Three said. Forgive me, but now is not the time to mince words.
She didn't raise her voice, but there was no mistaking her frustration. They were all on edge, the chairman was sure. In a few short months, their plans had gone from far-off theory to a cold, hard reality. They were leaving the Earth behind. Forever. Even with all the facts, it was an excruciating decision. The plan meant that none of them would be able to say proper goodbyes to so many people they knew and loved, and Monique only served to remind them of that. They needed to know that he understood.
I won't lie to you, he said. Would I like to see my daughter before we go? All of you have spent the past few months having surreptitious get-togethers, right?
So yes, of course I would.
But did I orchestrate the whole thing so I could see her?
Of course not. I suppose I could have pushed to make my appearance at the hearing a non-starter,
though in my mind walking away from my daughter like that would not only look bad, but would have raised even more suspicions. I weighed the risks, and I made a decision. I'm going. All of you will be on the worldview by then, and I promise I'll be right behind you. Nothing on earth could keep me from that.
Bring her, if you can.
The chairman looked up, mildly surprised at Five's words.
Thank you,
he replied. But I'm not optimistic. The sudden tightness in his throat surprised him more than Five's comment had.
What I am optimistic about, he quickly continued, is the realization of our dreams. In less than a week, 30+ years of planning will come to fruition. The next few days will be forever etched in human history, with each of us at the epicenter. Don't forget that. We're helping to guarantee the survival of our species.
It was a bit over the top, but no one called him on it. The conversation continued, mostly last-minute details and even a bit of reminiscing. Rudy remained, the chairman noted, asking questions and offering to help where he could. The chairman half-listened while his thoughts drifted back to the UN hearing, and to Monique. His speech to the rest of the committee had been heartfelt and very close to the truth, but as always, he had reserved a small bit of truth for himself. Did he want to see Monique one last time? He couldn't deny that he did, even beyond his curiosity as to the source of her powers. But that was only part of it, he knew. First and foremost, the hearing would be his swan song. It was more than a little egotistical, he knew, and if the others knew the full truth, they'd likely consider it reckless. But he was willing to take that risk for one last chance to set the record straight. One last chance to explain to the world how horribly they'd been misled. He couldn't have asked for a better platform.
3. I love those who can smile in trouble, who can gather strength from distress and grow brave by reflection. 'Tis the business of little minds to shrink, but they whose heart is firm and whose conscience approves their conduct will pursue their principles unto death. Leonardo da Vinci. The first few weeks had been by far the most difficult. The Iranians had separated her from her friends, leaving her to her own thoughts. Her encounter, Monique still wasn't sure what else to call it, had left her confused, exhausted, and with an emptiness at the pit of her stomach. It wasn't hunger. The guards fed her well, and they seemed genuinely concerned for her well-being. None of them would answer her questions, though, and without a translation device, she couldn't even be sure they understood what she asked. Over and over she replayed the events in her mind. What had she done wrong? Everything had seemed so perfect. She had been so sure. First the funnel, exactly as she had seen in her visions. Then the lights, leading her forward. And at last, the voice. She could still hear its warm, dulcet tones as it bathed her in affirmation of her efforts and her true purpose, right up to those last moments and their final words. This path has ended. It had been like a knife to the chest, severing the connection to her inner place and tearing at her spirit. She barely remembered and hadn't resisted as the soldiers escorted her to the truck, transporting her and her friends east along the Caspian coastline and then south through the Alborz Mountains to Tehran. Except for Pax, of course. He had somehow vanished, abandoning her to her own fate. Jonas had done his best to console her during the ride to Tehran. He described how Pax had leaped into the funnel in an apparent attempt to save her, or at least to try to warn her. Tabia, Anna, and Pierre also tried to pitch in, but she had waved them off. She needed time to think and to process the unexpected turn of events. Throughout the trip, Jonas refused to leave her side. The events in Ramsar seemed to have produced a change in him as well. In Tehran, captivity soon morphed to routine. Hours became days. The days soon transformed to weeks. She meditated often, making the leap as she searched for answers. But her visions no longer changed. She saw the same swirling funnel, the same lights, the same stream. But there was nothing else,
No new faces and no clear direction. Still, she clung to the vision as a sign of hope. It was still there. At least, it hadn't abandoned her. Her sense of purpose also remained as a steady tug from deep within. She resolved to find a new path. The thought of escape was never far from her mind. Opportunities presented themselves daily, as if mocking her refusal to tear down the prison walls. On her first night, she tested the metal bars of her cell, rattling them against their cement moorings. She used her powers to push them outward until a crack began to form directly above the door. But then she stopped. Her friends were here, and she wasn't leaving without them. In fact, she wasn't entirely sure she was ready to leave Iran. Not yet, at least. Not so long as her visions still pointed to Ramsar. Or until a better alternative emerged. She didn't abandon her powers, though. Instead, she passed the time having some harmless fun with the guards. It began with a subtle rearranging of items on their desks whenever one of them left the room. But soon enough, the cat was out of the bag. She couldn't avoid laughing as they argued over who was to blame. Before long, she was providing demonstrations and once again testing her powers. One night, while her only guard slept, she pulled all the pictures from the walls, sliding them through the bars to hang them in her cell. This time, it was the guards who had laughed. Not long after, the visitations began. Colonel Faraz Hassani was the first. He had been there in Ramsar, shouting orders from one of the helicopters. He spoke fluent English and politely requested she explain her actions. Her answers were short, often a simple, "I don't know," or "You should ask Professor Hanssen." For some reason, the second response seemed to frustrate him more than the first. But she never wavered from what the group had agreed during their ride to Tehran. She didn't remember much from the trip, but she did recall Jonas's final words. "We were looking for dark matter. That's all you need to say." She stuck to the story, and in the end it seemed to be enough. The colonel never contradicted her or claimed that the others had provided a different answer. It became a routine. He would bring her tea, then nod his head as they repeated their 20-minute ritual. Then he would leave. The American ambassador visited the most often. He brought her news from the outside world, including updates on American efforts to negotiate her release. He insisted she call him Ashraf. He was kind and empathetic to her plight, but he asked the same questions and he seemed less satisfied with her short answers. At times, he pressed her, all but demanding she provide additional details. In response, she would change the subject, asking about her companions or the status of the negotiations. His answers were equally terse. It wasn't until the UN arrived that the pattern began to change. Ambassador Henry was a self-important peacock, of that she had no doubt. But he seemed genuinely committed to securing her freedom. On his very first visit, he told her that Tabia and the twins had been released. The news hit her like a punch to the gut, though she felt a simultaneous adrenaline rush knowing they were safe. Now only she and Jonas remained. She couldn't imagine any of them were having much luck with Jonas. Soon after, Ambassador Henry convinced the Iranians to give her access to a live news feed. She was skeptical of his claims, along with those of Ambassador Gorbani, that the world's population remained obsessed with her story. It had been nearly 5 months since the events in Ramsar. Surely the ambassadors had exaggerated. As it turned out, they had not. Monique Durand, freak or fake? Will Andre Durand save his daughter? Officials remain stumped by the ghost of Ramsar. Hanssen and Durand, business or pleasure? Initially, she was taken aback by the headlines and the ongoing media firestorm. For the first time, she watched a video of what she had done in Ramsar. She had to admit the visuals were nearly as impressive from the outside as they had been from the inside. But the helicopters drowned out much of the sound, and it was impossible to tell what happened to Pax. He had vanished, same as he had months ago in the lab at Hanssen Scientific. As time wore on, though, Ambassador Henry seemed less interested in her story and more interested in her willingness to speak about it publicly, whatever her story happened to be.
The public demanded an explanation, he said, and negotiations were at an impasse. The UN had stepped in and brokered a deal. Would she speak at a UN hearing in exchange for a promise of release? Monique was caught off guard by the request. She had steadfastly refused to answer the ambassador's one-on-one questions. Now they wanted her to answer questions for an audience that might number in the millions? The deal made little sense. What was in it for the Iranians? But in the end, she agreed to consider the offer. As if to prove his sincerity, Ambassador Henry arrived the next morning with a surprise. Jonas, looking drained and a bit haggard, though generally no worse for wear. He smiled when he saw her, slipping through the open cell door to give her an extended hug. She returned his embrace. It was hard to believe they hadn't seen each other in months. A warm familiarity swept over her. Their history together might have covered a scant few days, but already she could feel an important brick returning to her inner foundation. She took half a step back, looking into his eyes while keeping a hand on his forearm.
"It's good to see you," she said.
She spoke in a low tone, almost a whisper. Her Iranian captors had been kind, but that didn't mean she trusted that they weren't trying to eavesdrop. Jonas responded in a similarly soft tone.
"Sorry that it's just me and not Pax," he said as he glanced around the cell.
Even the tone of his voice had changed, it seemed. He sounded more apologetic than sarcastic. She shook her head.
"You're here? He's not."
"Did you get to see Tabia or the kids?" he asked.
"No, you?"
"No, just a bunch of politicians and the guards."
"They've been released. It's just us now."
Monique nodded her head toward the monitor in the corner of her cell.
"They gave me a news feed a few weeks back."
"Yep, I heard they were gone," Jonas replied.
"Any idea why?"
Jonas shook his head.
"I can see why they wouldn't want to hold a couple of kids, but I'm not sure why they let Tabia go."
"I think they're still together," Monique replied. "I programmed my feed to find any mention of them. Tabia's doing a good job of sticking to our story. Last I heard, she had taken them all to Sharm el-Sheikh on the Sinai Peninsula. Apparently, she has some friends there."
"I have an English-speaking guard," Jonas said. "He told me when they left, though I haven't heard anything since."
"Have you heard about this UN hearing?"
Jonas nodded. "The U.S. ambassador has been in to see me a couple of times, Ambassador Henry. He seems to think it's a good idea."
"Do you trust him?"
Jonas shrugged.
"He's a politician."
They were both silent for a moment, until Jonas leaned in, speaking in an even softer voice. She could feel his breath at her left ear.
"What have you told them?" he asked.
"Nothing," she whispered in reply. "Like we agreed. We were looking for dark matter and trying to test your theory. I keep telling them they should talk to you." "Sorry," she added. "I hope that was okay."
Jonas nodded as he took her by the arm and led her to the small cot at the corner of her cell. He sat at one end. She followed his lead, sitting close enough that they could continue to whisper.
"It's fine," Jonas said. "In fact, it may have been more than fine. I can tell you about that in a minute. But what about you? Have you seen another vision? Any idea what's next?"
"No, it's still the same. The group of us at the stream with the funnel, nothing new. It's like they said, this path has ended."
She tried her best not to let her tone betray her disappointment or her frustration. "No more cryptic messages?"
"No."
Jonas nodded, accepting her simple answer. For whatever reason, he seemed to have lost much of his skepticism. Again, Jonas glanced around the cell. Monique stole a quick look as well. The guards had disappeared, as if happy to give the two of them a moment's privacy. Or perhaps they wanted her and Jonas to get their stories straight.
"They know about your powers," Jonas said.
Monique shrugged. It was the price to be paid for the games with the guards. But she didn't mind. The voice had told her, "The next step belongs to your species." The secret wasn't hers any longer. "And about Telios genetics," Jonas added. "Tabia and the twins both have a link to Telios as well."
"I know,"
she said. Initially, this bit of news had caught her off guard. She had yet to come to grips with her own genealogy,
thanks to her father's malicious claim that her mother, in fact, was anything but. The latest news further complicated the equation. Was Telios, and by extension her father, the source of both her visions and her abilities? I saw the news feeds, she added. They're having a field day with it, obviously, though I'm not sure what it means. I was never that close to my father's research. I wonder if it's another reason for this UN hearing, Jonas said. Maybe they want to get your father back on the stand. Did Ambassador Henry say anything about it to you?
No, he just asked whether I would answer questions. He's never seemed all that interested in what my answers would be.
Sounds like a guy with ulterior motives.
True, but I've got my own motives.
Have they changed?
That's the question, isn't it?
For months now, she had debated the meaning behind their words. This path has ended, they told her. Still, she refused to believe it. Otherwise, it had all been for nothing. Bima's death, as well as Kali and Brent and Kat. She couldn't bring herself to accept it, no matter what their words seemed to imply. The next step belongs to your species. She latched on to the glimmer of hope buried in their final words. She would search for a next step wherever that might lead, and whatever the cost.
Do you remember what I told you on the ride to Tehran? She said at last. They told me this path has ended, but also that the next step belongs to your species. Maybe Ambassador Henry is doing me a favor. I think it's time to go public.
It makes sense, Jonas said, though he stared at the ground as if speaking to himself.
What does? She asked.
Why they did it, he said.
Did what?
Jonas looked up again, locking his eyes with hers. I assume you kept telling them that we were after dark matter. I'm guessing Tabia did the same. A few months ago, they showed up in my cell with a communication line along with some equipment.
What kind of equipment?
Mostly computers, the stuff I needed to continue my work.
You've been working on dark matter? For months? All by yourself?
No, I've been working with Kaito.
Kaito? He's okay?
Jonas nodded. They let him go, just like your dad promised. Kaito's been helping me from the university.
Have you had any luck?
Jonas smiled. We have a theory.
4. The pure and simple truth is rarely pure and never simple. Oscar Wilde. Rudy and Victoria sat huddled at their favorite table, tucked into the far corner of the cafe. In some ways, it seemed like old times, the pre-dawn hour, the hushed tones, the sharing of secrets, though mostly the feeling of us against the world. Back then, their joint plotting of his rise through the ranks at GRI had seemed heady business. Now it seemed nigh on frivolous, and Rudy didn't particularly enjoy being reminded of that. Victoria listened patiently as he recounted the details of the most recent executive committee gathering. He didn't leave anything out, from the golden ticket details to the Hanssen asteroid, as well as the update on Hanssen himself. Over the past few months, Victoria's interruptions had become less frequent. She would let him finish before leading the conversation down one of a few now familiar paths. This morning was no different.
We're almost out of time, she said at last.
I think we may have been out of time before we even started.
Don't say that, she said. It's not over. Not yet.
We need to face the facts. The golden ticket event is this weekend. The passenger lists are done. Hell, most of the passengers are already on board. The truth is, we showed up too late to derail decades of intricate planning. I've tried to find chinks in the armor. Believe me, I've tried. They're too smart for that.
Any luck reaching the other committee members? You said Grace had made some progress.
Not really. I know I was optimistic a few weeks ago, but even the best AI assistant on the planet has her limits. We traced my own holophone connection back to the source, but the consortium's private network scrambles everything from there. She hasn't been able to locate any of the other members, at least not without risking exposure.
But we know who they are.
Sure, we know the who, but not the where. That's why I needed to trace the communication signal, There are a couple of them I thought I might sway, but I had to do it in person, not on public communication lines, and definitely not over the consortium's private network.
Which ones?
That hasn't changed. 3 and 6. They're the most skeptical.
You're still not going to tell me their names?
Victoria, we've been through this. It's not safe. One slip of the tongue and it's over. It's better you don't know. Honestly, it'd be better if I didn't know. A short silence passed between them. Rudy used the moment to strengthen his inner resolve. He was going to need it.
Where does that leave us? Victoria asked.
Rudy took a deep breath. The world view and the star view are going to leave on Saturday, he said. They really are leaving. It's inevitable.
Exactly. They are. We are not.
We've been back and forth on this for months, Vic. I understand how you feel. Until now, it's been a hypothetical. If we can't stop them from leaving. It's no longer a hypothetical. The asteroid is here. The worldview and starview are all but loaded. Our slots are waiting. Victoria shook her head vigorously.
We're not going. I don't know how else to say it.
She leaned back in her seat, arms crossed. There was no mistaking the finality in her tone. A passing stranger could have seen it in her posture and written all over her face. And Rudy was no stranger. A long night is about to become an even longer day. I know it's not ideal, he said. For any of us, especially the kids. But we need to weigh it against our other options, and I can tell you staying behind isn't much of an option.
Staying behind is an option, especially with the consortium gone. We can survive here. More than survive, in fact. It may be rough at first, but we'll deal with it.
I used to believe that, Rudy said. But I don't think it's realistic. Play it out with me. 20,000 people leave Earth behind, along with a quadrillion-dollar asteroid that belongs to my company. Someone has to take the fall for that.
You didn't know. No one left on Earth will have any idea you were involved.
Maybe, Rudy said. I don't think it will play out that way, but for the sake of argument, let's say that's the case. Let's say I somehow managed to avoid being fired by the GRI Board of Directors or thrown in jail. Then what about the rest of it?
The rest of what? She asked.
The rest of what they're taking. Those hotels are a complex public-private partnership. A bunch of the resources and infrastructure used to build them came from public funding. We're going to take it all.
How does that become your fault?
Who knows? Maybe it's my fault, maybe it's not. But the public will want a scapegoat and I'll be on the short list. A very short list.
Maybe they won't need a scapegoat. Maybe they won't care.
Really? We steal trillions and no one cares? That's not realistic.
Think about it, she said. What happens to all the money these people are leaving behind? The government will seize it. That would pay for all of it 100 times over. Everyone's happy, including us.
Rudy nodded his head. He could see her logic, but only because he hadn't told her all of it. I see your point, he said. But it won't happen that way for 2 reasons. First, the rest of the passengers aren't billionaires. In fact, very few of them are. The consortium built the passenger lists based on the skills and expertise they'd need for the trip. They have a long list of qualifying criteria. In fact, being a billionaire works against you. They assumed the billionaires would refuse to leave when given the choice.
What about the consortium members themselves? Victoria asked. Andre Durand is the wealthiest man on the planet.
Again, Rudy shook his head. That's the second reason, he said. They're no longer trillionaires. They've exhausted most of their fortunes in this decades-long quest. The chairman hinted as much to me a few weeks ago. The money they've been spending approximates the economy of a mid-sized nation. It's hundreds of shell corporations and millions of jobs. What happens when you wake up one morning and all of that's gone? Victoria didn't immediately respond. Rudy could see the wheels spinning as she returned his stare. She's finally coming around, Rudy thought. Or not.
Maybe we could be the good guys, she responded.
With GRI's resources, we could bridge the gap. We could offer jobs, stimulate the economy, that kind of thing. We could be the heroes.
You're forgetting Gunner's model, Rudy responded. I know it's not your favorite topic, but every day I'm more convinced that he's closer to right than wrong. When's the last time you let the kids go to the grocery store on their own? When's the last time the news feeds had anything good to say? And by the way, they're reducing the water rations in the city again, starting first of the month, Senator Pavisi told me.
Believe me, the consortium is absolutely sure. It's only a matter of time once they take their hands off the wheel. This may be the straw that breaks the camel's back. I hate to be the one to say it, but there's no reason to stay, especially for the kids.
Victoria shook her head, apparently still not convinced. But again, she took her time before responding. If there was another angle to explore, she would find it. Sure enough, she changed tacks. Tell me more about Olympus, she said.
Good sign, Rudy thought. It was the first time she had shown any interest in the consortium's destination.
I can show you some of the photos when we're home, Rudy said. The chairman showed me a few the other day. They're incredible. It's a fascinating story. Do you remember the Starshot project?
I don't think so, she said.
About 30 years ago, a public-private partnership called the Starshot Project shut down a decades-long effort to send thousands of tiny nanoships to the stars. They had spent billions of dollars, but by the mid-30s, the government had bigger problems here on Earth, and private space investment had turned to more profitable endeavors, like the moon base and helium-3 mining. The chairman and his colleagues stepped in, bought the assets, and quietly finished the job. Eventually, they sent 1,000 nanoships toward Alpha Centauri. 20 years later, they started receiving data. In particular, readings from a planet they now call Olympus.
Because of the mountain, she said.
Yes, the first images showed a rocky surface and an enormous mountain, double the height of Mount Everest. But more importantly, proof of liquid water, moderate temperatures, and a strong enough magnetic field to shield the planet from solar flares and radiation.
And an atmosphere, she said.
Rudy nodded. We already knew about the atmosphere from earlier analysis done here on Earth.
I don't want to mislead you, Vic, he added, because the truth is, Olympus is nothing more than a direction of travel. It's a possible carrot at the end of a very long stick. Those nanoships made the trip in 15 years. The worldview will be lucky to make it in 100.
We'll never see Olympus.
No, but the kids might.
Victoria was shaking her head again. It's crazy, Rudy. Flat out crazy.
It's never been about Olympus. We need to think of the worldview as the destination. It's self-sufficient and state-of-the-art. Not to mention the opportunity of a lifetime, several lifetimes.
It's an oversized coffin.
Now it was Rudy's turn to shake his head. Gunner and the consortium call the Earth an even bigger coffin. Maybe not for us, but certainly for our kids and our grandkids.
You were right before, Victoria said. I never really bought into their doomsday models. But to be fair, I never studied them either, and I know you did.
Victoria paused for a moment, seemingly to gather her thoughts.
Here's the thing, Rudy. I'd still rather roll the dice here on Earth. It's our home. Those aren't our people, and we're late to the game, like you said. Socially, we're on the outside looking in, while simultaneously stuck inside looking out. I still say no. Sorry.
Rudy fell silent as he digested her words. He was afraid the conversation would end here, even after doing his best to build a case. In many ways, he agreed with her. They were too late to alter the consortium's plan, which left them to choose between the lesser of two evils. Unfortunately, he hadn't finished telling her about all the evils. She's not going to like this last part. There's one more thing I need to tell you, he began. I just put the pieces together myself over the past few days. It's not something I've been keeping from you.
Wonderful.
I told you the consortium members have spent most of their money. It's all relative, of course. What remains of Andre's money leaves him with more than most could ever imagine. but they've made plans for the rest of it as well. The money that stays behind.
Why would they care about that?
The chairman cares. He's obsessed with his legacy. He likes to say that history is written by the victors, but in this case, the victors won't be around to tell the story, in his mind at least.
They're paying someone to do that?
He's paying people to protect his legacy and to protect the plan. He let the words sink in. As usual, it didn't take Victoria long to connect the dots.
Fixers, she said.
Most likely, and others, I'm sure. They can't have anyone chasing after them or doing anything else to disrupt their endgame.
That would make us a threat if we decided to stay.
We'll be a threat the moment we don't show up for the golden ticket event. They'd assume the worst.
And then they'd do the worst. In case you've forgotten, it wasn't just Carl they took care of when he became too much of a risk.
Rudy saw the smallest of tremors in Victoria's hands as they rested on the table. Neither of them spoke as she processed the implications, now laid bare between them. At last, Victoria stood, collecting her jacket and purse from the back of her chair. She leaned over and gave him a kiss before pausing to look him in the eye.
I have to get back to the kids, she said. They'll be up for school soon. You need to find an option C.
What's option C?
I don't know, but you do it all the time. We're not leaving, and we can't stay. So find an option C. It's what you do best, right? Out-of-the-box problem-solving?
Rudy nodded.
Then get us out of this damn box, she said.
5. If you do not change direction, you may end up where you are heading. Lao Tzu. For what seemed the thousandth time, Pax dissected the final moments in Ramsar. The funnel of light, the helicopters, the troops, culminating in Colonel Hassani's threat to destroy Monique and her Tower of Light. He had counted 11 soldiers, each of them with a rifle trained in his direction. Even amidst the tumult, they seemed to have little trouble identifying the primary threat. As far as Pax could tell, the kids hadn't noticed the military's arrival. They stood transfixed, staring into the tornado of lights. Tabia had clearly noticed, though she held her ground next to the twins. Jonas also stood nearby, frozen in place. He looked lost, a mix of shock and confusion written on his face, hands on his head, fingers intertwined. Pax couldn't recall the precise moment of decision. It was as much instinct as conscious thought. He had crouched low like a coiled spring before simultaneously activating his bodysuit and launching himself toward the funnel. No shots were fired. He hadn't expected any, given the ongoing maelstrom. He braced himself as he crossed into the lights. Did he feel something? Did they counteract the effectiveness of his bodysuit? He couldn't be sure. But without question, he hadn't collided with Monique or anything else of substance. In barely a heartbeat, he was through to the far side. It was all he could do to retain his balance, stumbling and rolling across a short expanse of grass until he reached a small copse of trees. Once there, he dove to the ground, at the same time turning to gauge whether his actions had made an impact. Apparently, they had. He had watched as the funnel splintered, the lights racing down and away like a runaway roller coaster. A rush of air knocked the others to the ground. Pax could feel it as it passed over his head. Monique reappeared where the base of the funnel had been only moments before. Had he somehow passed through her?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.